Welcome back, and welcome to this session where we have a wonderful panel to discuss the understanding of the land acquisition litigation in India from the perspective of different stakeholders in this process. And I think I want to start by thanking Namita and her team for really presenting us with an incredibly rich and interesting material that gives us all a basis for understanding this process in a different way. And also, Namita, thank you for the presentation, which I thought was very clear and made it the material and the significance of the material very accessible and very clear to all of us. So thank you very much for that. And the way that we will proceed with this panel is that we'll start by giving 10-12 minutes to each of the panelists to give us their perspective on the land acquisition, litigation, and the complex from each of their positions. And then we should have about an hour. We have 2 hours for this panel. We should have another hour where we'll open up for general discussion. So just sort of keep your questions and be ready. I think we'll do the panels in we'll do the presentations or the comments in a row and then open up. And so the panelists are, and this is the order in which they'll speak. So the first panelist is Mr. K.P. Krishnan, who is the Secretary of the Ministry of Skills Development and Entrepreneurship and has a long experience from different government positions of dealing with this complex that we're talking about today. The second commentator is Usha Ramanathan, who's well-known academic in the field of law and poverty, and has written extensively on many of the several issues, but on many of the large land acquisition cases or issues relating to the Narmada Dam and other. No.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. And I'm sure you all know her work as well. The third speaker is Kanchi Kohli, who's also with the Center for Policy Research, the NAMATI EG program. She's a researcher, writer, and also an activist in the area of environment and land issues, and also with the wealth of experience that you can bring. Our fourth speaker, Gopal Sankaranarayan, is also a very well-known figure in this field. He's an advocate for the Supreme Court. He's a prolific writer and also a founder of the organization Care for Air. So also sort of sharing this deep concern also for environmental issues. Our last but not least speaker in this panel today has come from Ahmedabad. And he is the founder of the organization Yamin Adhikar Adolan, mobilizing farmers in the context of land acquisition. So as you understand, we have a real treat today listening to all these very, very important perspectives. So Mr. Krishnan, please.
Morning, everyone. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks, Namita, for this, what I think is a unique opportunity, unique in more ways than one, looking around the table for a topic that is so closely connected with the state. I think I'm the only serving government functionary here, which strikes me as something interesting. But empirical sort of evidence and data-based conversations on public policy are relatively rare occurrences in India. I think within that, serious and rigorous conversations on land, as opposed to purely impressionistic ideological conversations, are even rarer. So I think it's a truly unique opportunity in that sense, and I'm happy to be here and happy to have been involved in this exercise off and on and being able to sort of contribute marginally to it. I'd like to compliment the entire team and the organizers for the report as well as this event. I'll now take the 10, 12 minutes that I have to focus on the couple of general issues and three or four specific issues that Namita suggested that we should focus on. Let me start with the first of the many issues that she highlighted, which is, why do we have such a proliferation of legislations on land acquisition? A part of it is the sort of textbook constitutional answer that this is a concurrent list subject. So there is legislative competence which is with both the parliament and the state legislatures. I think like the many central laws, including some of the laws that get mentioned in the fourth schedule of the RFCT LARR of 2013, central and state laws, which are self-contained legislations on specific domains. For instance, there is the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Remains Act, or I may have got the precise wording wrong, an act that deals with archaeological issues. There is an act that deals with atomic minerals. Now, a lot of these were conceived as self-contained legislations dealing with all aspects of that domain. One aspect of that domain is to do with land acquisition of that particular ancient monument or a piece of earth which bears atomic minerals. So I think the initial surge that you see in land acquisition legislations, both at the union level as well as the state legislature level, go back to this need for self-contained legislations covering all aspects of a topic, including land acquisition. Taking the specific example of Karnataka that I'm a little more familiar with, we have a legislation called the Karnataka Industrial Areas Development Board Act, which is primarily an act to promote industrialization, and the thinking then used to be creation of industrial estates, clusters, and there is a whole bunch of other things that the KIADB, the board, does. Land acquisition was one of them, and the act gave the KIADB some powers relating to land acquisition. And likewise, there are legislations which were passed to carry out the various interstate river tribunal awards on irrigation projects. They were time bound, and therefore there were land acquisition related parts in those legislations. And then we have legislations which deal with SCST housing, to give an example, where it was felt that we needed a fast tracked process for acquisition. So the explanation for why do we have many legislations on this subject, one part of the answer is this. But I think somewhere along the way, what happens is this tail of a provision relating to acquisition in a larger legislation dealing with industrial development then begins to wag the dog. So KIADB is now almost entirely a landlord. It does very little in terms of actual industrial promotion. It's ended up becoming the arm of the state to essentially do land acquisition. And I'm talking about the pre-2013 situation, because some of these legislations would need to be reenacted, et cetera, et cetera. But we're talking about the period that she covered in her report. Now, I think there is a general Indian ambivalence on markets, and especially relating to land. And my personal sense is both the old law and to some extent the new law either are at best agnostic or actually do not recognize whatever, whether it's a fully functional, half functional, dysfunctional market on land. Now, the new legislations that came about, the KIADB Act or the SCST housing or the irrigation related acts, some of them were acts that pushed the concept of recognition of a market for land to one side, and the others were enacted to push it in exactly the opposite side. So even if you had a market, quote-unquote, related value, there are legislations which explicitly say you need to ignore that and take a fair value which the acquiring authority will assess. And the KIADB Act, for instance, the reason became popular, it actually gave complete discretion to the board to effectively negotiate outside of the formal acquisition framework the right to negotiate and purchase land. And the reason why industrialists and big industry wanted this was the usual problem relating to lack of clarity on title and an intermediated activity. An activity intermediated by the state ensures title thereafter. So all of what you think is the IT revolution of Karnataka, Infosys, Wipro, all of these were negotiated land purchases brought about by KIADB. And where the industrialist came and told the KIADB, you negotiate whatever price you think is right. We are prepared to pay X number of times the so-called formal determination of market value, which will flow out of the old act. So I think the larger question that this poses, and I'll conclude this particular set of observations with this point, is A, should there be these all-encompassing domain-specific legislations, because this is not a land acquisition problem alone. This is in the Indian legal public administration system, you will see this across. There are self-contained legislations which initially start with the best principles available at that time on a particular domain, incorporated in the omnibus legislation. Thereafter, that specific individual domain of land acquisition may have moved forward, but my omnibus legislation stays where it was. So, A, that's a general Indian public administration related issue. And two, there is also, I think, a typical Indian solution to a large intractable problem. Everybody dealing with land acquisition by the mid-90s knew this was already completely broken. But can we get a new legislation on land acquisition? Sounds very difficult. I am focused currently on ensuring Karnataka's IT sort of activity gets a fillip. Can I therefore ring fence this little problem and find a bypass solution to what is actually a badly functioning heart? So I find a temporary short-term solution to an immediate problem, and the larger problem sort of stays somewhere else. And this small problem, which I fixed, ends up becoming often a large problem later on. I'll stop here on this aspect of multiple legislations. Three or four other points that Namita related to. The incentive structure of the entire land acquiring hierarchy. How does it work? And we've discussed it extensively when she and her team came. I'll just refer to a couple of points. Again, something which all of you will know. To get land acquisition done quickly and get development going is often the explicit mandate given to all of the district officers. And I have, for instance, I did the entire Konkan Railway land acquisition from what was then undivided Mangalore right up to North Canara. And it was a budget announcement made by the then railway minister. My chief minister said, we have the legal responsibility to hand over unencumbered free land to the Konkan Railway Corporation within X period. If this doesn't happen, this project will not be funded by the union government. So do what you can. In the next 8 to 10 months, I want complete physical possession of this entire stretch from point A to point B completed before X date, and George Fernandez and I will show up here, or I don't remember the railway minister, it's perhaps George Fernandez, we will show up here to inaugurate or start the work. And I'm giving this as an anecdotal example. Similar, urban water supply and drainage for the city of Mangalore. Now, the city of Mangalore expanding population, hugely increased size of the city. In a 10-year period, it is more than doubled. It doesn't have underground drainage. There is an ADB-funded project, which is time-bound. Government of India has gone and signed the project. The state government has signed the project. And this is, again, a symptom of how we do things in India. I have signed an underground drainage project, after which I start looking at the alignment. And I take 3.5 years to figure out the alignment. And now there are 6 months left for this project to be closed. So what am I told? Complete this land acquisition, because this is a public cause. Is there anybody in Mangalore who doesn't want underground drainage? Everybody wants good quality sanitation and drainage. And therefore, whoever is objecting is just being a pain you know where. And all of these guys who are shouting Zindabad and Murdabad are also the guys who come and pillory you when there is lack of sanitation and outbreak of cholera and malaria. So therefore, get on with it. Get your land in place. It's a question of compensation. This is an ADB project. We can pay more than normal. So typically, that's the incentive. Plus, on the specific question of why the recorded value, I can give you 100 instances of land acquisition officers who've been to jail for giving what was considered to be excessive value. I know of not even one guy who has faced any punishment for giving less. That's the way the Indian state works, and that's the way the Indian collector is going to respond. Are you going to be able to change all that? It's a question worth pondering over. I have 1.5 minutes. Two quick points on constraints. Poor quality of land records, inadequate personnel for all of these very difficult functions, measurement, survey, valuation. Try doing a land acquisition. I don't know how many of you know the ground reality. To get a 1 acre valuation done with the current state machinery will take the life out of you. Huge constraints in terms of state capacity. That's an issue which you've highlighted. UP versus Karnataka. I think there are some statistical suggestions I have. We don't know the base. What is the quantum of acquisition in these states? So the absolute number of court cases, I don't think, are indicative, but they perhaps are indicative of excessive litigation. My other sense, which didn't come out in your presentation, I think both UP and Karnataka probably refer a lot to Bangalore Development Authority, Noida type land acquisition for urban development and town planning, where compensation actual values are 100x what is going to be given in the best land acquisition valuation. So people will question the acquisition, not the valuation. I've run out of time. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you so much. This was very, very interesting. Then I'll give the word to Usha.
I think I'll do a bit of shorthand talking because most people here will know what I'm saying. But I just want to start with saying this, that it is true that it's actually very, very unusual for us to have even one serving bureaucrat in a meeting like this, so we're very happy to have you here. But it's also to reassure
only
you.
One was invited.
Possible, but it's also because of past experience where we don't get too many. We've invited many and not, you know, we normally have empty chairs which say that somebody didn't come. But it might also make you happy to know that there are, in fact, many people in this room who have grassroots experience on what happens on land acquisition. So we are not talking in a vacuum. So that's kind of help. I think, see, the thing about eminent domain is that eminent domain is really only about private land being acquired for a public purpose on payment of compensation. And like Namita said, following the due process of law. The eminent domain does not, doctrinally, it does not impact on all those lands which are not privately owned and where there's no private interest, where the state, you know, where the relationship of the state with that land has to be understood. Which is why I don't, did you do the, you said you took away all the land reforms cases and the Zamindari cases. So do you have Kameshwar Singh in it?
No, sir, it won't be in this set.
Yeah.
It will be another set of cases. We have that data.
Because Kameshwar Singh is one of our central points from where we understand how the idea of property and of land acquisition and of the relationship between the state and land got raised and did not get answered. So it went on with the compensation part of the cases, but did not really address the question of who is the state in relation to land. And that becomes important because while in the early years of, you know, of development here, early years of independent India, the focus was on the zamindari cases. In later years, from the 80s especially, you find that the focus shifts completely from, you know, we use the term land acquisition, but what we are talking about is mass displacement. So the idea of the public changes then, and I would just like a little tweak on your thing of livelihood, because it's not just about livelihood. Project affected people are people for whom much more than livelihood, in a sense, is a reductionist reductionist statement about what gets lost. So one of the very important junctures in this shift in our understanding of eminent domain is when we started recognizing that it was mass displacement that was happening. And mass displacement is of people who will not be able to assert rights, many of whom will not be able to assert rights under the Land Acquisition Act. So So yesterday we were in fact discussing in some of these classroom situation that in the 50s, what seemed like a good idea and a necessary idea may not be a good idea or a necessary idea in the 90s or now. And I think part of the explanation has been provided by Mr. Krishnan, where he says that the state simply doesn't have the ability, we don't have the people, we don't know how to do these things, but we do it anyway. And the problem has come because, one, it's not just about being participative, but it's about being coercive. And when you say it has to be done in 6 months, you can't do it unless you're going to use coercion in some form or the other. Which is why I think it's become important that today, when we're talking about land acquisition, one of the first places we look at is to see what is happening in terms of land conflict. And it's through land conflict that we are understanding acquisition. And that's the place which we've reached today, and that's a serious kind of place. The interesting thing about the land acquisition, the 2013 Act, from your study, I mean, after I've read your study, I'd be interested to see how much of the Land Acquisition Act of 2013 has derived its understanding from court decisions, which is how, you know, we as lawyers think that, you know, it kind of develops through the way, you know, courts function. There's a continuity, there's an evolution, and then you bring in law. And how much of it has come from action on the ground? If you look at many of the provisions that have been introduced into the 2013 Act, they've not come from the court. In fact, they have had to defy the court to bring those provisions in. For instance, questions of return of land when you don't use it for that public purpose. When you talk about legitimacy, it's also about illegitimacy of the land acquisition process that has come, which courts will not recognize because courts are essentially, one, they are status quo as institutions, and therefore you can only have incremental change there. You can't have more than that. And two, they have to be necessarily, and we would ask them to stay within that, be concerned with the letter of the law and what the law asks them, you know, what the law permits permits to happen. So if change has to come within that, it can't come from within the law itself. It has to come from without. And I think the Land Acquisition Act of 2013 is the most, along with the Forest Rights Act maybe, but even more than the Forest Rights Act, I would say, has the imprint of experience much more than any other law has. And that's what makes the law so complex. The changing understanding of this idea of land acquisition is also that when we had the constitutional framework, you know, it's in the fourth amendment to the constitution, the government at that time, when they were, you know, asking for the amendment to happen, they were saying that, you know, we need access to minerals. We need access to that which is lying under the soil. We also need, interestingly, they say in that same statement of objects and reasons, that they need to clear slums. So there is a certain vision that they had of what a developed nation should look like and what you need for that developed nation. I think it's a bad idea for us to look at 1950s and judge it by today's standards and today's experience. Today's experience is that rehabilitation doesn't happen, coercion is exercised, procedure has got shrunk so badly that it almost doesn't exist. We've had to stretch out that procedure as much as is possible in the 2013 Act because procedure basically had death in the practice of the Land Acquisition Act of 1894. Now, the things that mediated it, the kind of things that were impossible for them to, you know, it was not just about the market and it was not just about coercion, was the recognition that the Constitution does not see all land in this territory as the same. There is no uniformity. There are multiple ways in which we see this land. And one of the ways which we can, you know, obviously see is what happens in fifth schedule areas, which we'll be discussing, you know, maybe later today or tomorrow. Now, this fifth schedule tells us that the relationship of people to land has to be respected in a certain kind of way. In non-fifth scheduled areas, the presumption has been that the state can exercise its power of eminent domain. The question that has remained inadequately answered and not well answered by the Supreme Court, by my understanding, is what is the relationship of land, what is the relationship of the state to land which is not owned by private individuals? So can they just do what they want with it? Now, in the LARR of 2013, there is a very interesting provision, which I think, sir, you're going to have to contend with at some stage, because it says that you can't have a project start off. Now, what do you have? Like in compensatory afforestation, you say, you started with saying a forest, then you said, okay, you can't do it, so pay money, somebody else will do it. And they said, just pay the money, you forget about it, and you carry on with your project. Afforestation will happen separately, and all you have at the end of it is a fund and no forest. Now, in the in the LARR Act, they've said that you cannot have change of user of land till rehabilitation is complete. Now, that's a very big statement. And the law is interesting because it shows the tensions between the people who are asking the state to acquire land for them and give it to them without any encumbrances, and people on the ground who are saying that, listen, you can't do this to us. And our experience over this 50 years says that you are incapable of making certain that we are not impoverished, that we are not marginalized, that we don't become victims of development, but that we also become participants in development. So while in fifth schedule areas, there is a certain kind of constitutional respect that has to be given to people who live in fifth schedule areas for the scheduled tribes, that constitutional respect is not demanded for the rest of the country. But fundamental rights are demanded for the rest of the country. And following the law, and if you can't deliver on what you promise in the law, can you carry on with what you're doing? So if it is not possible, then do we really need to start having a serious discussion on a changed model of development? Is this the right model of development? If on the one hand, we have the climate change and environment and, you know, all our surface water and everything getting polluted, that's one whole set of issues that we have. But we also have the inability of the state. Now, we find that when it comes to inability of the state, there is privatization that's being asked in all other places, saying, you drop it, you're incapable of doing anything, hand it all over to us, and the state is handing it over in many, many spheres. Now, here, when there is inability of the state, what is it that you do? Do you nevertheless go ahead and use your police powers and take over the land and do what you can with it, or should there be a complete rethink on this? Which is why I think the question of moratorium has been mooted multiple times. It's been mooted in terms of fifth schedule areas, you know, quite stridently, and generally that you can't have this. And when you say that there are very few cases from Chhattisgarh, at this stage, it's kind of, then the court is not a relevant location. It's happening somewhere else, that's all. And I would question this assumption that you make that if people can reach the court, it speaks of empowerment. To my mind, it speaks of reaching the wall and then going to the court. So it is not, I'm not sure. I mean, there are people with more experience who will be able to tell us this.
The point is more that in categories of disempowerment, this is the most privileged group.
Maybe not. I mean, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm just saying that if we were to look at it as figures, maybe, but I'm not sure. I'm not sure that that's what the implication is. And when people come to court and why they come and what they go away with. So there are multiple kinds of things. So this is one whole element. I think the other thing that we may need to look at when we look at land is also the forest debate. Because if we don't look at 23% of the land has been reserve forest. So it's like that territory has had a very nebulous status over the years. Until 2006, people there were treated as encroachers, as, you know, wrongdoers, whatever. So it's not just the fifth schedule areas, but it's forest across where there are no fifth schedule, where it's not a fifth schedule state too. And that, you know, the contestation that's happening now between, say, the forest department and the forest dweller, because this law has come in, and the kind of disempowerment that the forest department seems to feel, which they are trying to you know, undo in many ways, including, you know, tiger reserves, elephant corridors, whatever, whatever. I think that's a contestation that we'll have to watch and what the court does with it. I think when it comes to the qualitative part of this kind of research, it's interesting to see what makes the change. Like Noida was something that the parliamentarian was able to understand because it's near Delhi, it's urban, you know. You look at even the, I mean, you forget about the judges, you look at even the parliamentarians, there's been a kind of disconnect between parliamentarians who are getting elected and the distant parts. The more remote you are, the less likely you are to be known. So the idea of representative democracy too in that sense has changed a little bit. And courts, you know, if you ask them to understand PESA and to understand, you know, that there is self-governance, which is different from governance, which is different from administration, it will be difficult for courts to understand it because we don't even have them. I mean, I've been going around all the law schools and nobody even teaches the fifth schedule. So if they don't even know what it is, how are you going to be able to apply and see the difference? So I think, you know, at the end of your study, when the way I'll be using it is also that I want to see how much difference is acknowledged by courts and they recognize it. I want to see how much they understand the coercive power of law and of the Land Acquisition Act and what it has done. And I think our experience of the 2013 Act is not sufficient for us to, you know, make any great, there's no great understanding that we've yet derived from it. This is broadly the framework within which I was thinking when I came to your.
So thank you very, very much. This was incredibly interesting. I want to actually depart a little bit from the original plan because Mr. Krishnan will have to leave probably during or just after the next speaker. So I was wondering if there are some particular questions. Maybe you could take a couple of questions just now in case. Yes, and please, if you could just state your name. I forgot to state mine, so I will do this. You probably recognize that I'm not Pratap, as I was supposed to chair this panel. My name is Siri Gloppen. I'm the director of the Center on Law and Social Transformation, and I've been a collaborator on these projects throughout. So yes.
I'm Kurt Falia, chairman of the Alternative Futures. So we think of the future right up to 2050. Now the question is, everybody has their own plans in various sectors, but nobody thinks of the population and how much is required of land, water, forest, other things. So I have a suggestion that a new law should be suggested. The chairman had raised that point and partly Samurti has already replied to part of it. Now I'll give you the sequence in which this thing can be done. Number one, the areas which have been acquired or in the process or the project has been sanctioned and not started or some such thing, leave those out. They can be settled in the court or otherwise as the case may be. Now let us think of the future. Today we have a population of 130 crores. Which is likely to stabilize at 160. That means another 300 crore people are going to come, besides the one who are already unemployed. So our basic question is how to provide employment. Now, keeping all that view, at present we don't have any records of how much of land is used for each sector, and how much is just lying empty, vacant, with various government and individual organizations and corporations. So number one, that has to be known so that then you know how to divide that land for various sectors and purposes. Once that is done by a multidisciplinary team in which all types of people who come up with investment projects and all those things are also included, and they can all decide as to which sector is available for what type of purpose. For instance, oil or steel or urbanization or transport, infrastructure, let that team within 2 to 3 years decide all this. Once the land is decided, then the question of acquisition or the other things would have been settled with regard to environment, forest, water, and disposal of waste and everything, so that those are taken care of, they don't have to come later. It is only after that, that when you have selected a sector and a project is suggested, or it is said that we would like to this area to be used for such a type of sector, then that land can be taken auctioned, not just given by anybody to anyone who likes, because that land has been found suitable by various professionals, and therefore it can be done. So it will become much easier and faster after that to get hold of the land and all the facilities that are required for that particular project. So
thank you.
In that public sector purpose, people say it is for public sector. All the development is approved by the government or whoever is there, and therefore it is for public purpose, because it will be either invested by the government or invested by the individuals. But
thank you so much. Thank you so much. In the interest of having many people speak, just please be very quick. I'll take 3 more short questions and then I'll give the word. Okay.
I'm Barun Mitra. I had a question for Mr. Krishnan, because you said it is very true that the court cases, the numbers would be better known, appreciated if we have the baseline, like how much was the quantum of acquisition or how many were instances of acquisition in Karnataka or Uttar Pradesh. Is there a way to create an inventory for this, given your experience on the ground? Because we have been looking for ways to figure out where and when and how land has been acquired, but it's quite a challenge. So is there a way to create an inventory so that the kind of benchmark you are saying can be established? So, and it can go forward as well in terms of the state identifying perhaps the potential future acquisitions that might be necessary before that rather than after.
Very specific question to Mr. Krishnan. My name is Ravi. I work with Samata in Mines, Minerals and People. While I've been working with the tribal communities recently, I personally got into an issue with the government about my land. There was a government order that was passed by the Urban Municipal Administration and Urban Development Department of Andhra Pradesh, saying something about land pooling of some 100 acres, and my land seems to be on the next to it, so they've just included it. And there are 3 GOs passed without my consent, and a few other landowners' consent. And it's like, say, 3 days, I've still to get back and see what is that GO and what is the whole process. So did, in your experience with Karnataka, any such land pooling thing was done, or this is just new for Andhra?
Yeah, Mr. Krishnan, I will give you example of Haryana, very typical near Gurgaon. You see, in Gurgaon, 25,000 acre land was acquired for the purpose of development and social. It has never happened, particularly Reliance was the beneficiary. And, you know, to convert agricultural land to commercial land is called a CLU. They charge more than crore rupees, and land value is less than 10 lakhs. What issues of CLU? Second is whether they can convert for the Roman material is a typical case. He borrowed land, he used change heads 2-3 times. So how many heads can change in a case? Thank you.
Thank you very much. There are many, many people who would like to ask you questions, but I think that we'll just leave it at this and you can have some comments and then we'll have to get on.
Thank you. My apologies to my fellow panelists. I didn't mean to be disruptive. I had warned Namita earlier because I have moved to a different domain and I have my parliamentary standing committee, so it is non-negotiable. 3 remarks. Mr. Barun Mitra's point about land acquisition inventory. I struggled with it for 2.5 years, partly as a response to a parliament question. We've not made even a marginal headway. We've now, at least before I left the Department of Land Resources, we had gotten into an agreement with ASCII, Administrative Staff College of India, to physically go around state by state and first get, you know, we used the list that Namita has of getting the legislations under which land can be acquired. Even that is not available. And then the government, the word government used in a legislation refers to the department in the allocation of business rules, which will deal with acquisition. So this data is not available with the revenue department of a state. This data will be available with at least, you'll need to go to at least 10 departments at the very least to get 90% of the acquisitions. And if you want 100% of the acquisitions, it'll be about 18-20 departments per state. And this has never been collected. This has never been collected inside a state, and there is no pan-India database. So the answer is a disappointing, sad no. But it's well worth the effort of, I think, researchers to do this. And you'll need serious cooperation of state governments. And in the post-2013 times, this data has also become very sensitive politically, because state governments think that we are, at least the government of India was collecting this data to figure out the number of cases in the twilight zone, you know, which fall because of the 24-2 retroactive operation. So they've just clammed up. They do not give this data. They may give researchers, but they certainly won't give government of India. The municipal example that you quoted, sir, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka did not have a land pooling example. He may be able to give examples from Ahmedabad. Years ago, Ahmedabad didn't call it land pooling, but the Ahmedabad Urban Development Authority had done something similar in the form of, they had a different name for it.
Town planning scheme.
Town planning schemes, where the, I think the logic was very sound, which is the heart of the land acquisition problem is, in the best case where we know it is genuinely a public purpose and the work is genuinely needed, let's take that example to free it of controversy. The difficult question is, why should that one entity, for instance, if you have to locate a distribution overhead tank, geography tells me that it has to be at the highest point in this vicinity. And that highest point happens to be my piece of land. But the beneficiaries are the entire Lodi estate, Lodi colony area. So for a million people benefiting, I am the only loser of land. How do we handle this disproportionate burden of development that's falling on me? And how do we distribute this? Ahmedabad actually cracked it very well. They made everybody part with 1/100th of a small piece of land, and they actually created a piece of land. So when I lost an acre for an overhead tank, I ended up getting 0.99 acres right next to it, and everybody ended up losing. So this was successfully done in at least two or three cases that I have personally seen. Is it replicable on a large scale? Huge issues of state capacity, honesty, integrity of process, etc., etc. Karnataka did not have land pooling, so I have no personal experience. Yours was a set of observations. I have nothing to add, sir. CLU is not really a land acquisition matter. It's a very difficult and different domain in urban development, and that's a whole separate conversation. It is effectively depriving a person of right to property without calling it deprivation of right to property. And I think there are a whole bunch of court cases on effective change of land use. For instance, if you mark my land as green belt under the Bangalore Development Authority Act in Karnataka, I lose complete right of development. The state has decided that my land is going to be a publicly available green land, but the state will not acquire it. It will continue to be in my possession. I'm technically the owner, but I can do nothing with it because nothing will be approved. Effectively, it is land acquisition without being called as land acquisition, but courts have refused to call it a denial of right to property. So they've given a lot of excuses for this to carry on, but I think that's a very different and difficult conversation. I wouldn't like to get into it because it'll take you the next 2 hours.
Hands can change it.
Meaning, if I own a piece of land, I sell it to you, can you sell it to another?
In public purpose.
Huh?
In
no,
public
but.
Purpose.
No, no, but that's not a land acquisition case, ma'am. That's not land acquisition. I presume he's talking about private.
I think we need to. I'm sorry. This there's too many important and good conversations in here. But I think we need to. I need to. Think we need to sort of stop it here. But thank you so much again, and thanks for joining us, and thank you for the questions. I think we'll just continue with the next speaker. So, Kanchi Kohli, would you please continue?
Okay, it's actually always fascinating to be in a meeting on land because it just fires up from all ends. And this is not just land, it's land rights, land acquisition, and inclusive development. So I think the subject matter is ripe for this kind of a discussion. Thank you for this opportunity. I think the report, I was part of some of the earlier preliminary findings, and it was a very precise and very illuminating kind of discussion and presentation that you did. And so thank you. I'm looking forward to actually going through the nitty-gritties of this report. I just had one point up front that I wanted to state, that one thing that that came up was the cases were divided in terms of those which accepted the legitimacy of the law and sought compensation, and those which did not accept the legitimacy of the law. And the only slight difference, and perhaps you didn't really, you meant it like that way, is that it's the interpretation of the experience in that court case that is accepting the legitimacy of the law. It's not necessarily the people who are facing that problem who are accepting the legitimacy of the law. Frankly, you actually have no choice. When you're served a notice, you have no choice. So the pitch in the court could either go, I'm accepting it, give me a good compensation, or what you strategically decide when you go to court, or do you go to the administration. So that's one thing that I wanted to just say up front. And I just wanted to basically start with a story in some ways. And there was a lot of, discussion about Chhattisgarh. Ironically, my story is on Chhattisgarh. And just earlier this week, I was sitting with a bunch of young guys who had organized themselves on the issue of land acquisition. And what they were trying to do basically is they were trying to do two things. One, they were pursuing judicial remedies in the court on unfulfilled promises of the land acquisition, which most of us know about, jobs, compensations, rehabilitation, all those kinds of issues. You go to any of these parts, you'll get all those issues that come up. The other one was they were organizing a very interesting musical protest objecting to the expansion of one of Asia's largest coal mines. The interesting thing was there that they actually didn't have much faith in all the, because they had the unfulfilled promises on one side and they had the new acquisition. They kind of knew that this is not going to be, they didn't want the story to be repeated. What was interesting here was that this land that is going to be acquired for the acquisition had been acquired almost 14 years back. And the Land Acquisition Act of 2013 did not apply. It did not apply because this land was acquired under the Coal Bearing Areas Act. So the new Land Acquisition Act talks about the retrospective clause with respect to the Land Acquisition Act, but not with respect to the Coal Bearing Areas Act. And that's where the irony of the situation comes in. Of course, they will be talking about it in different ways and going about whether the musical protest comes up or not, does well or not. But this is the kind of narratives you see around land acquisition and inclusive development in most parts, because this is the second phase or the third phase or the fourth phase of land acquisition in areas where people have seen it. It's not the first time that this is going to happen. One of the points that Namita had actually requested some of us in the very precise set of things that you wanted us to focus on was, do people really have faith in the court? I think what is interesting is that the courts are still seen by many as the one place where violations, inaction, all that can be addressed. There is in many ways a dependency of litigation. And the dependency also is because there are interpreters of the law. So in the interpreters of the law, whether it's lawyers, civil society actors, researchers, are all the experts. They are the experts who will tell you that, okay, the best way to go about this is let's go to court. But, you know, what is a larger question is that, you know, and you've raised that in your study, in terms of why is it that the cases land up in court? One thing that has very clearly been pointed out is that the administrative machinery often is not just unresponsive and inaccessible, but because they don't do their job. So you say, okay, executive is not responding, you need to just go to the judiciary and get the response. The other thing is the interpreters of that problem say court is the best bet. You know, many of us actually have been party to that thing that, okay, let's just go to court and get that action. But if that gap actually changes, if we actually change that gap of the knowledge of law and where you can get remedies, will that every time lead people to court? Because what you're seeing is that let's get the best, either the best lawyer or the most socially responsible lawyer and just go to court. You know, and that's not just with the Supreme Court, but that's also with several high courts, district courts. So the idea of actually bridging that gap between of knowledge, and not just knowledge of the law, but knowledge of how to use the law, you know, that I think would try and make the administrative machinery. We are trying to do that with several of the environment cases, but I think with land acquisition that also will be a very important thing to do, especially things like retrospective clauses, etc. Just the bridging that gap. The third point I wanted to talk about is, again, one of the issues that was flagged. Can actually better implementation resolve the disputes? And that came up. You know, you spoke about if the social impact assessment is done properly, would that resolve this dispute? If you do a good consent process, will you arrive at a good decision? That those are the kinds of better implementation. If the administrative machinery is given all the powers, all the wherewithal, will that actually resolve the problem? The interesting thing is that experience with many of these laws which talk about public participation or public response, the current response, and for a long time actually the response has been, is that anything that is process oriented, anything that is going to take time, is tough. Because you're dealing with two ends of the spectrum. You need to move fast. And you're also talking about progressive clauses that are talking about process. Arriving at consent requires deliberative democracy. You know, you need to sit down, talk, figure out, okay, if I'm going to give up what I'm going to give up, it's for this, that, and the other. That takes time. Arriving at a decision takes time. And we are not willing to wait for it. We are not even willing to do good, quick, you know, proper studies. But it's leave alone arriving at a decision which agree, where 70% or 80% of the people agree, and everybody's livelihoods and other rights are recognized, and everybody is duly compensated. My God, you know, it's really like that. You know, but the fact is, if you really want to be true to democracy and to deliberative democracy, which the progressive clauses of the legislation talk about, I think this is the only way forward. And you spoke about that section 109 where the states are empowered to make rules. Instead of engaging with this process where you arrive at processes of justice and deliberative democracy, where people can use their agency to resolve, you know, respond to these problems with that knowledge of law, actually the gap has been broken. What we are seeing, and we tried to do this over only based on secondary data last year, in a short working paper on what are the state governments actually doing. And you see, most of the time, the progressive clauses, which are process-oriented, are being watered down. And they're being watered down primarily, or new kind of processes are coming up, which say, okay, even when it's a land pooling system, etc., everybody will be given equal compensation. The few who don't want to engage in the land pooling, what do? That option doesn't exist. I should have a choice whether I want to go to the land pooling mechanism or want to go through the land acquisition mechanism. And the final point I actually wanted to make is this thing about the applicability of the retrospective clause. I think it's come out very strongly that it is one of the most political clauses in this legislation, because you're talking about reopening many of the things that have gone. I mean, the Coal Bearing Areas Act acquisition is different, but even if you go down the 1894 law, you're actually talking about reopening. So there are very interesting cases actually that come up. So one is, of course, the kind of cases that have come up, one in the Supreme Court, two is those which have come up in the High Court. So the Gujarat High Court actually is listening to, hearing a case on the Reliance SEZ where the validity of Section 24 itself is being questioned. Is that a valid clause or not? So when that opens up, you see how politically volatile this is. And the link to this thing is, does every case of retrospective, retrospective clause operation need to go to court? See, the law does not talk about you need to go to court to get it activated. The law says it is in retrospective action. Where are the rules or administrative procedures that talk about this can be done at the collector level? You go, all the RAN records are there. Why don't we just get it activated there? The law doesn't really talk about it. And that challenge is also making people go to court, even if you don't want to. Finally, I'll end with another story. Not too far away from Odisha. Chhattisgarh is another state called Odisha. And there, it was not really a land acquisition case, but we were sitting and generally talking about what are the kinds of issues that you're facing. We were trying to look at, is the mine causing pollution or those kind of things. So somebody actually came up with a piece of paper in front of me. And they said, the thing is, the power plant right next to us has been defunct for the last 8 months. It's shut down. Many of us used to actually work there. But prior to it getting defunct, we had actually sold land. Can we actually get the land back? Because now that it's defunct, we don't know when it's going to be opened. At least the land where it's standing, give that to us. Maybe we'll restore it and start using it. So we looked at the papers. The papers actually had a very interesting clause, two very interesting clauses. One which will not come as a surprise to many of you, which is the land had been sold in national interest to a private company. The deed actually said that. You're selling this land in national interest. The other is, basically, the seller shall not raise any further demands on the buyer in the future. This is a legal document signed and sealed. And that's the bridging the gap of the law that I'm talking about. If these things are known, you actually have a little more agency to talk about it. It's a huge gap. I'm not saying it's going to happen overnight, but I think somewhere, working with the administrative machinery to know this is where the answer is. Yeah, so I'm actually wondering if this case goes to court, actually, what are they going to say? you have no right to ask anything. Yeah. And just one small point is that, in the conclusions, the solutions is about, a lot of the solutions are about lack of records, capacity. I think the problem is also a little more. The government machinery can do with a little more capacity, but there is a whole political economy of this debate. Whether it's delays, why this is happening, and I think the points about your title about inclusive development actually lies at the heart of it. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We will know, the next speaker is one of the users of this legislation and a participant in the litigation. So we've been looking very much forward to hearing from you. So please.
Thank you, Siri. I just want to start by congratulating, I think, the Center for Policy Research, and specifically Namita, Ankit, Pallav, Dhruv, Shubham, and Upasana, who have worked on this report. I've always lamented the fact that as a practitioner, we find a huge gulf between what we actually are putting across in court or having put before the court and what actually is happening on the ground. So, even specialist lawyers in other courts lament about the fact that the Supreme Court is just sending law in all sorts of different directions. I think that's true even of interpretations of human rights and civil liberties and things like that. So the kind of data that's come out is, I think, fascinating. I've always wondered whether trying to figure out a common thread in how a court functions is much like how a toddler looks at his mum yelling at him and wonders, look, yesterday she was so sweet, today she's yelling at me. It's very difficult. It's very, very difficult to find common threads over case law, which are written by different individuals over many years with different mindsets and different influences, not all of them good, and trying to cull out some sense, because there's such a lack of consistency in that. But having said that, I'll just come down to the points that I thought I would like to address. There's an interesting quote which you've put at page 25 of your report, where you quote a collector saying, and because I believe a lot of our 1894 land acquisition cases always started with what the collector did. And the collector says, as eloquently put by one official, you say, "You don't follow the law, you only get abused by the court. But if you try to follow it, you might go to jail. It is for the same reason there is fear of being open to investigation," the official explained, "that the government appeals all the cases that it loses like an automaton, whether or not there is any merit in or likelihood of success in such cases." Now, the government has a national litigation policy, which I've brought with me, which broadly says that unless there are large questions of law or large losses to the finances and the exchequer of the state, the government shouldn't normally just go ahead bunging appeals, which is happening all the time, particularly in property cases. I think it's necessary for us to understand, and this is something that Mr. Krishnan also touched upon, about how collectors fear this. And I agree with him where he says that there have been hundreds of cases where collectors have been investigated for having raised the compensation level, but probably none where it's not. And for me, the solution is so simple. In every single legislation which involves government officials, public officials, you have a clause in the Act which provides immunity to them for their actions. Why is it that we have, even in the new Act, such a clause is absent? Now, I find it problematic because these are the people on the ground, and you know that they are scared. This is not a new issue. This has been happening for a long while. You give them that immunity, and then we'll see what actually takes place thereafter. Now, that for me would be a simple solution. Just thinking off the top of my head. Another fact which I think you've brought out very well is the fact that this Act is litigation friendly. There's so many aspects of it. The old Act was litigation friendly. There's so many aspects of it on public purpose, on compensation, on whether you're an affected party or not, on the abuse of the urgency provision. And all of that used to come to court again and again. I think that has been addressed in some fashion in the new Act. When I first read the new Act and the bill in late 2013, I was gobsmacked. I was shocked that parliamentarians were allowing such a law to go through. I agree with you in some part, Usha ma'am, that you know there are many parts of this law which are unique in the kind of interests, competing interests that it addresses, which, and I'm surprised that it passed muster. I'm actually very surprised. There are many parts of it which addresses and constantly says that if there are any other laws anywhere else which are more beneficial, then this law will give way, otherwise it won't. I was particularly surprised by a statistic that I found from the report, which says that as much as 63.4% of the litigants before the court had accepted the acquisition process, but had only challenged the compensation aspect. Now, I found that quite surprising, because more often than not, our experience, at least in courts, is that we are almost, I mean, in a large number of the cases that we've been arguing, we question whether there was a public purpose, whether these lands are contiguous, whether that project can actually be practical. And the fact that many of them accepted this could either go two ways. One, that they find it futile to even challenge this, you know, especially when everybody else in the community who are also going to court are not challenging the acquisition process. You stick out at the stark example. The other is because you know, and this is another statistic of yours, that from the notification period till the Supreme Court judgment, it takes 20 years. They might have just thought, look, we know from experience this is going to take a long time. We're in it for the long wind. So we might as well just argue for the compensation and just hope that the market value aspects of it will benefit us. And that's something that the graphs in your report seem to suggest, that the higher up the ladder you go, there's a good chance that the compensation will be increased. That may not be commensurate. It may not be relative to the time periods, but it is possibly just a consequence of spending so much time in courts that, you know, courts are also sympathetic to the fact that the value of the land has gone up. I was curious about a finding of yours that post the 1990s, there's been a kind of spurt in the litigation on the land acquisition, specifically years 95, 96. You say there seemed to be a lot of, possibly not the litigation, but the judgments, judgments in that period.
Disposal.
The disposal, yeah. But again, you point out that in the Supreme Court, the cases take 6 years from High Court to Supreme Court, essentially, average. So I was wondering, there seems to be an increased amount of litigation post the 90s in any case, in many other spheres apart from land as well. A large part of it possibly comes from, I think just people being a little more prosperous to be able to afford to go to court, maybe. Also that I think the number of lawyers who've come into the profession, the numbers have really spiked from the late 80s over the last 20, 25 years. I don't know whether that's a good sign. Do we have more problems, or do we just have better lawyers or more lawyers or whatever? But I think the advent of social media, the advent of issues like this being shared, look, the court said this, the court said that, I think is leading to greater awareness, and more people are coming to court about that. There are two problems that I have with the way the Supreme Court deals with getting these cases to be heard in the first place. The first is bunching, which you've dealt with, where they put cases together. Now, this is something that the Supreme Court, in its registry at least, in following typical bureaucratic procedures, insists that any prayer that is made in a Supreme Court SLP will only say that grant leave to appeal against judgment dated so-and-so of so-and-so. So it gives no idea to the person who is sitting in the registry or to the judge as to what really you're asking for, unlike a writ petition in the High Court, which tells you what your prayer is. So they just club random cases together, and then you spend a lot of airtime in court trying to convince the judge that, look, no, this has nothing to do with the other case that with which it's linked. So bunching is actually a problem. They have no systems at all to bunch them. It's just randomly done. The other is the multiplicity of parties, which is something you touch upon. Eventually, you know, you have a land acquiring authority, you have the government, and you have possibly a beneficiary for whom the land is being acquired, apart from the various people whose lands are being taken. So inevitably, a large amount of time in all courts is taken in small little silly things like serving each party, ensuring that the responses come, and contrary to the litigation policy, which insists that unless you want instructions taken, the government will have a hearing on the first date, they don't. A large number of adjournments, etc., are taken on that count. In Namita's email to us with instructions, like a cracking the whip, she had asked us to deal with the strategy that lawyers follow. Now, this mystified me because I don't think lawyers know how to strategize. We pretend that we strategize. We act very cool with the clients and say, boss, this is a good idea. While really we have no clue. It's like swimming with fish. The reason I say this is, and this is touching upon ma'am's point, that you know we don't teach the fifth schedule in law schools. We don't teach large amounts of practice in law schools. We have no clue when we step out, stumble into the profession about what we're supposed to do. So one thing we're not taught is about when not to file cases. That we're never taught because the money comes from filing. So one I think stark example, and this one Kancha pointed out, section 24.2, out of which now your statistics suggest that there are 200 and something judgments which have come in this 280 judgments in the 3 year period from 2014 to 2016, while the entire analysis of judgments concerning the Land Acquisition Act over the 65 year period was 1,150. Now that those are judgments. I can tell you, because I actually had to analyze this for a case that I was doing, there are more than 850 cases that have been filed in just the last 2.5 years on section 24.2. And I completely agree with her. There's absolutely no reason to have filed a single one of them. Section 24.2 says this. It says that the acquisition, if the award has been passed more than 4 or 5 years previously, and if, as a disjunctive, compensation has not been paid or possession not taken, the acquisition lapses. It's an operation of law. Parliament has said it. I don't have to go to court, say, please give me a declaration that it's lapsed. It's lapsed. Now, in case the government decides to act contrary to that lapse, then I challenge that action. Now, some guy decided, some brainy strategist lawyer decided in court about 4 years ago, hey, let's file a petition to declaration. Ho jayega. Ho gaya. He got the order he wanted. But the floodgates opened, as a result of which The DDA filed 600 cases, and Companion, the land acquisition collector, filed 600 cases, because both of them are challenging the same judgment. Now we are flooded, and the kind of strands that have arisen from that has again led to me questioning whether our judges themselves have any wisdom when they are applying their own precedents. A three-judge decision as early as in January 2014 stated pretty much the correct law on this position. Thereafter, clever government lawyers have come with their strategies to try and question various aspects of it. No, but in this one case, there wasn't a stay. There, the ordinance has come into effect. The ordinance has lapsed. They've referred these questions to larger benches of the court. And we are still mired in this litigation, which should never have started to begin with. And having started now, the judges of the Supreme Court should have followed precedent and not referred a single one of them to larger benches, which they did. And those, I think, were fatal mistakes. I have only 2 minutes, so I'm going to wrap up quickly. I won't go through points which I think are well made about the access to courts. It's a point which I think one of the persons you consulted, Nick Robinson, actually did an excellent paper on access to courts. And Mr. Venkatesan is here. The Frontline published that piece, and it's been used by the Supreme Court often to point out that if you are closer in location to Delhi, there are way more cases that you're going to file. So UP and Punjab and Haryana come into courts that often, and Delhi. I think it's a no-brainer. It's because of the proximity to it. There are a couple of other points I wanted to point out. One is a clarification that I thought it would be useful to have about how many of those acquisitions that you analyzed were arising from Chapter 7, which dealt with acquisition for companies, because I want to understand, did post-liberalization, because we have this crony capitalism issue, did a lot of it happen then, and what was the outcome then? 38 out of 12, but the period I'm saying, when it was, maybe, it may be useful to know when that happened. One final thing is, and this is a clarification, that your methodology, you've drawn a distinction on the tables between civil appeals and SLPs. I don't really think as a sequitur anything comes from that, because in practice in courts, they take up special leave petitions and they deliver an order on it. They could equally just say leave granted and deliver the same order on it. So the nature of what it is doesn't necessarily change. So maybe not much arises from that. One last thing from what Mr. Krishnan said about the KIDB and Karnataka. One of the biggest problems I remember growing up in Bangalore was there were certain ministers who at whose behest lands would be acquired, very lucrative lands around Bangalore. Just when you know that a project is going to come up, before you notify the project, you get the lands acquired. And then you notify the project. And then, strangely, exercising powers under the erstwhile Section 48, you withdraw the notifications of acquisition, right? And then that lands don't revert to the original owners, because in the meanwhile, a transaction has taken place to sell it to somebody else. Now, the profits from that were huge. The Devanahalli Airport, not so new airport of Bangalore, is an example of that, of large swaths of land which belong to actually hardworking farmers just being depleted like that. I would have loved Mr. Krishnan to stay to explain that. He also, like Agatha Christie, just left without telling us what happened with the Konkan Railway acquisition. I was curious about whether it finished in 8 months. But I would just like to conclude by quoting John Locke, where he said that where there is no property, there is no injustice. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sankaranarayan. That was also, I think you gave us a very good perspective on what it is to litigate these cases. Last but not least, I want to give the word to Sagar Rabari, who will give us the perspective from Ahmedabad and from the farmers' organizations.
If the house permits, can I speak in Hindi? Yes. My comfort level is better in Hindi. नमिता और पूरी टीम को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद ये मौका देने के लिए भी और इतना सारा काम करने के लिए भी पूरे रिपोर्ट में मेरे लिए जो सरप्राइजिंग है वो है कि रफली 30% ऑफ द जजमेंट्स कंटेंट नो इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट द पर्पस ऑफ एक्विजिशन इसी संदर्भ में रिलायंस का एक एग्जांपल है रिलायंस रिफाइनरी के पास जमीन थी सरप्लस, फिर उसने और जमीन मांगी सरकार से कि हमको स्टाफ कॉलोनी बनाने के लिए जमीन चाहिए। सरकार ने नोटिफिकेशन, एक्विजिशन का नोटिफिकेशन इश्यू भी कर दिया, किसानों ने चैलेंज किया, हाईकोर्ट में ये बात आई कि रिलायंस के पास जो जमीन पड़ी है उसमें वो आम की खेती करते हैं और कॉलोनी बनाने के लिए किसानों से जमीन चाहिए। अब जब आम की खेती का मसला निकला तो मैं उनकी वेबसाइट देख रहा था, रिलायंस पेट्रोलियम रिफाइनरी की वेबसाइट के एनुअल रिपोर्ट के अंत में लिखा है, केसर मैंगो कल्टीवेशन इज मच मोर प्रॉफिटेबल देन एनी पेट्रो प्रोडक्ट, और वो कितना आम पैदा करते हैं, कहाँ बेचते हैं, सब डिटेल दिया हुआ है। लैंड एक्विजिशन एक प्रॉफिटेबल बिजनेस है सबके लिए, इसका डेवलपमेंट से ज़्यादा कोई वास्ता नहीं है। गुजरात इंडस्ट्रियल डेवलपमेंट कॉरपोरेशन ने जितनी भी जमीन एक्वायर की, करीब 55% जमीन आज तक उपयोग नहीं हुई है, वो जीआईडीसी के पास ही है। कॉरपोरेट हाउसेस के पास जितनी भी जमीन है वो शायद ही उपयोग करते हैं, बाकी का उसको रीसेल करने में ही ज़्यादा इंटरेस्ट उनका रहता है। कच्छ का दो एग्जाम्पल है, अदानी ने सरकार से एक्विजिशन करवा के जमीन ली 1 रुपये से 32 रुपये के स्क्वायर मीटर के भाव में, 3 महीने बाद वही जमीन हिंदुस्तान पेट्रोलियम को बेची 2200 रुपया स्क्वायर मीटर, और इंडियन ऑयल कॉरपोरेशन उसको बेची 2500 रुपया स्क्वायर मीटर। जो एवरेज 11 रुपये स्क्वायर मीटर की जमीन थी वो 3 महीनों में 2200 और 2500 रुपये स्क्वायर मीटर की हो गई। जहाँ तक कोर्ट केसेस का सवाल है, कोर्टों का मेरा तजुर्बा बिल्कुल ही अलग है, जहाँ तक संभव हो मैं सबको एडवाइस करता हूँ कोर्ट में मत जाइए, अपनी जगह निपट लीजिए। 2 एग्जाम्पल देता हूँ, 8000 हेक्टर जमीन का निर्मा सीमेंट के खिलाफ गुजरात हाईकोर्ट में केस चल रहा था, मैं कोर्ट रूम में था, चीफ जस्टिस एडवोकेट जनरल को डांट रहे थे, अंत में उन्होंने कहा स्टॉप सेलिंग गुजरात और स्टे ग्रांटेड, स्टे दिया। तीसरी हियरिंग, उसके बाद बीच में एक डेट गई, उसकी तीसरी हियरिंग, वो ब्रोकर की तरह चीफ जस्टिस बात कर रहे थे, भाई एग्रीकल्चर एंड इंडस्ट्रीज कांट कोएग्जिस्ट, आप इतना छोड़ दो, इतना ले लो, यहाँ से कैनाल निकाल लो, हो जाएगा, दोनों का हो जाएगा, ये उनका काम ही नहीं है, उनको तो हाँ या ना करना था, वो ब्रोकर का काम उनको नहीं करना था। जूनागढ़ बाईपास का एक केस हम लोग गुजरात हाई कोर्ट में हार गए, सुप्रीम कोर्ट में आए, वहाँ किसान भी मौजूद थे, अफेक्टेड किसान सुप्रीम कोर्ट में, 2 मिनट में 68 केस बेंच ने रिजेक्ट किए, 2 मिनट 68 केस, उन्होंने क्या जज किया उसको, मतलब जुडिशियरी एक जुए की तरह हो गई है, आपका लग गया तो ठीक है, नहीं लगा तो भूल जाओ। 2 मिनट में क्या किया उन्होंने जो 68 केसेस निकाल दिए। मिस्टर कृष्णन गुजरात के लैंड पूलिंग की बात कर रहे थे, लैंड पूलिंग से भी एक कदम आगे गुजरात निकल गया है, पहले गुजरात में लैंड पूलिंग केवल अर्बन डेवलपमेंट के लिए ही होता था, अब इंडस्ट्रियल डेवलपमेंट के लिए भी लैंड पूलिंग होता है। उसके लिए एक नया एक्ट 2009 में बना, गुजरात स्पेशल इन्वेस्टमेंट रीजन एक्ट, SIR एक्ट, उसमें कहीं कोई कंसेंट नहीं है, लैंड एक्विजिशन एक्ट अप्लाई ही नहीं करता है, इसलिए वो कॉम्पेंसेशन वगैरह की कोई बात नहीं है। फिर भी पूरी की पूरी जमीन एक्वायर ही होती है, अप टू 50% डिडक्शन है उसमें। धोलेरा स्मार्ट सिटी का जो प्रोजेक्ट है वो इसी एक्ट के तहत है, उसमें 50% किसानों की जमीन सीधी बिना किसी कॉम्पेंसेशन ले ली जाती है। अब इंडस्ट्रियल डेवलपमेंट के लिए किसान क्यों कंट्रीब्यूट करे, इसके पीछे क्या लॉजिक हो सकता है? लेकिन जबरदस्ती उनसे कंट्रीब्यूशन लिया जाता है। दूसरा, उनका प्लॉट की साइट चेंज हो जाती है, जहां एडजस्ट होता है वहां मिलता है, तो फिर वो कैसे अपना खेती जारी रख सकते हैं जब प्लॉट ही यहाँ से उठा के दूसरी किसी जगह डाल देते हैं? मतलब उनकी पूरी की पूरी जमीन बर्बाद की जाती है बिना किसी कॉम्पेंसेशन के, और इसी में सबसे ज़्यादा करप्शन है, क्योंकि जो पावरफुल है उसे प्राइम लोकेशन पर प्लॉट एडजस्ट करके दिया जाता है, और जो नहीं बोल पाता है उसको कहीं कोने में डाल दिया जाता है, जिससे कि बाद में भी उससे उसका कोई फायदा ना हो। एक और बात है, कोर्ट में जाते हैं, इंडस्ट्रियल डेवलपमेंट के लिए भी लैंड पुलिंग को अगर चैलेंज करें, मैं तो हमेशा मना करता हूं, लेकिन किसानों को होता है कि शायद हमको कोर्ट से न्याय मिल जाएगा, क्योंकि उनके लिए वो फर्स्ट एक्सपीरियंस होता है ना। हम हाई कोर्ट तो गए, हाई कोर्ट ने स्टे भी दिया, वो उस मुद्दे पर दिया कि SIR एक्ट विलेज पंचायत के पूरे पावर्स को वायोलेट करता है, विलेज हैबिटेट के बाहर उसका कोई ज्यूरिसडिक्शन नहीं रहता है, और पंचायत को कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ने पावर दिए हैं, तो स्टेट एक्ट वो छीन नहीं सकता। ये टेक्निकल ग्राउंड है, लेकिन सुप्रीम कोर्ट में ये टिक पाएगा उसका मुझे कोई भरोसा नहीं है, क्योंकि आखिर कोर्ट भी यही कहते हैं कि डेवलपमेंट तो चाहिए ना, और इसी डेवलपमेंट पर मैं एक बात और कहना चाहता हूँ। जो सर बात कर रहे थे फ्यूचर की, फ्यूचर प्लानिंग, रोजगार के नाम पे सबसे ज़्यादा जमीन गुजरात में ली गई, और बेरोजगारी का दर गुजरात में बहुत ऊंचा है, रोजगार कम हुए हैं बढ़े नहीं हैं, ऑटोमेशन के चलते और भी रोजगार छीने जा रहे हैं। जिस प्लानिंग की बात करते हैं, ये प्लानिंग शब्द क्या है मेरी समझ में ही नहीं आता है। पूरा जो DMIC का रूट है उसमें इतने स्मार्ट शहर बनेंगे, इतने इंडस्ट्रियल रीजन बनेंगे, ये बनेगा वो बनेगा, पूरे रूट में पानी ही नहीं है, लेकिन पूरे उसके वो रिपोर्ट में कहीं ये नहीं लिखा है कि इसके लिए इतना पानी चाहिए और यहाँ से आएगा। मतलब बिना पानी के ही वो डेवलप कर देंगे, उसी को वो प्लानिंग कहते हैं। ये मेरी समझ से बाहर है। अगर आपके पास प्लानिंग है तो हर चीज़ का जवाब होना चाहिए, पानी कहाँ से आएगा उसका जवाब ही नहीं है। दो रिसोर्स है जिसकी बहुत अहमियत है, और दोनों की पॉलिटिकल इकोनॉमी है, जमीन और पानी। मैं नर्मदा का एक छोटा एग्जांपल दे दूं, जो बांध बना 0.20, गुजरात के हिस्से में 9 मिलियन एकड़ फीट पानी आया था, 0.20 मिलियन एकड़ फीट इंडस्ट्रीज के लिए अलॉट किया था। 2014 में 0.25 मिलियन एकड़ फीट तो ऑलरेडी दे रहे थे, मोर देन 40% पानी मिसिंग है, उसका कोई हिसाब नहीं है। डैम से रिलीज होता है वो आंकड़ा है, डिस्ट्रीब्यूट होता है वो आंकड़ा है, लेकिन ऑलमोस्ट 50% पानी कहाँ जाता है किसी को पता नहीं है, जबकि मैक्सिमम इवापोरेशन रेट 8-10% है, उससे ज़्यादा नहीं हो सकता, वो पानी इंडस्ट्रीज को बेचा जाता है। ये दो चीज़ें हैं जिनकी पॉलिटिकल इकोनॉमी बहुत ही पावरफुल है, इसमें सबको मिलता है, इसलिए कोई किसी की नहीं सुनता है। धोलेरा SIR कि एक और बात करूं, टाइटल की हम शेड्यूल एरिया में और सब जगह बात करते हैं, लेकिन लैंड रिफॉर्म के जो बेनिफिशियरी थे उनको भी तो ज़मीन मिली थी, टेनेंसी एक्ट के तहत मिली थी, सीलिंग एक्ट के तहत मिली थी, 50 साल से अधिक हो गए, उनकी तीसरी पीढ़ी अभी खेतों में जाती है, लेकिन रेवेन्यू रिकॉर्ड में उनके नाम कहीं नहीं है। जब लैंड पुलिंग होता है तब जिनका टाइटल में नाम ही नहीं है उनको तो बाकी 50% भी नहीं मिलेगी, तो उनकी तो पूरी की पूरी 100% जमीन जाती है। ऐसे केस में यहाँ तक हम लोग आगे बढ़े हैं कि हमको हमारा दुख और दर्द कब दुनिया के सामने रखना वो भी पुलिस तय करती है। यही जिन लोगों के टाइटल नहीं थे जमीन के उन लोगों की एक फुटमार्च लेके और गिनती के, ऐसा नहीं कि बहुत बड़ी मात्रा में हो हल्ला करते हुए जाना था, 100 लोग पैदल चल के कलेक्टर ऑफिस जाने वाले थे, उसके लिए परमिशन नहीं मिली, हाईकोर्ट जाना पड़ा कि हमको परमिशन दिलवाओ, हमको ये बात कलेक्टर को कहने जाना है, फिर हाईकोर्ट ने परमिशन दिया। इतना गुजरात आगे बढ़ चुका है। मेरा समय खत्म हो रहा है, मैं यही बात को खत्म करता हूं कि हमारा दुख दर्द भी कब कहना वो पुलिस तय करती है। धन्यवाद।